Well, this weekend is one of the most important weekends in the Christian calendar. Of course, you have Christmas when Jesus, God himself, became a human being. But this weekend is what that means for the world. What does it have to do with us? What was the purpose? What was this God become a human being going to accomplish in the world? And we're doing something a little different this year. I think we need, all of us, in the midst of the turmoil and anxiety that we all face in life, we need a little more of a reflective Easter weekend. And so we're going to talk about a tale of two gardens. And I'm going to just do something maybe a little bit different. And both today, Good Friday, and Easter Sunday, I'm just going to read through certain story in the New Testament about Jesus and then just kind of reflect on it. So hopefully you'll join me in that. If you have a Bible, or just sit back and listen to the story, and then I'll stop and apply it to both Jesus, which is what this weekend is about, but then also what his work actually means for you and me. So, a tale of two gardens. Of course, the first garden in the Bible is the Garden of Eden, where God had this plan of people actually flourishing and worshiping him, but then that failed, and Adam and Eve sinned and listened to the voice of Satan and listened to temptation versus listening to God's plan for their life. And so there had to be another garden, and actually two gardens. The first one that we're going to talk about today is the garden where Jesus comes just before he gets tried and crucified. And then there's the garden of the resurrection, which we're going to talk about on Sunday. So here's the story of the first garden, Gethsemane. I've actually been there. It's this beautiful spot in Israel with these beautiful trees. And the story is that Jesus has come into Jerusalem during Passover, and the crowds are riled up, the Jewish authorities are riled up about him, and they're nervous about the revolution that he's starting, and this group of people around him that are starting to talk about the fact that maybe their leadership isn't good, and they're following the one who's going to actually redeem Israel and redeem the world, and they don't like who Jesus is and his version of messiahship and being the king, and so they start to go, no, we don't really like this, and so here's what happens. Matthew 26. Let's reflect together this weekend. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." Just reflect on this for a moment. Jesus is about to face the ultimate suffering emotionally, physically, spiritually, and we're going to see that progress. And yet he goes, he says, "Sit here, and I'm going to go over there and pray." And one of the things I think we miss in our Christian life is we talk about Jesus' sacrifice for us. We talk about his rising from the dead. We oftentimes don't realize what the rest of the New Testament goes on to say, that Jesus is interceding on our behalf even now. He stands at the right hand of the Father praying for us. Almost like the Father's looking at us, and when we sin and we mess up and we're scared and we're in that thing that we're not sure we can get out of, Jesus almost says, "Hey, look over here, I'm praying for them," and the eye of the Father moves on him. It's a beautiful image, Jesus constantly praying, and we see that a lot in this garden. Of course, this garden and what happens here and what it goes on to do is the reversal of the failure of the first garden. You see, the first Adam fell to temptation and caused all the sin that this garden then needs to reverse. And then the garden on Sunday needs to reverse. And so he says, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." I love it. Think about that. That's a great little gospel verse that we might not think about. It's in Matthew 26, 36. "Sit here while I go." It's religion says you have to work for your salvation. You have to please God. You have to do things. And Jesus goes, "You sit here while I go do the work." And then the accomplishment and the victory that I do, that then gets applied to you while you sit here. This is the great gospel pivot of life. It's the difference between reading your Bible as if you're David in the David and Goliath story that needs to slay the giants of your life. And it's like, no, no, you're the scared Israelites up in the hill hoping that David's victory gets imputed and applied to you, even though you never lifted a hand to accomplish it. This is what our life is. We either trust to ourselves in the end. We either stand before God in the end and say, here's my record. Judge me. Let me into heaven based on what I did. Or you're going to get to heaven and you're going to say, judge me based on Jesus' performance for me. And I find hope only in the second one. Sit here. Underline that if you have a Bible. Well, I go over there and pray. Verse 37. And taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, that's James and John. We've been introduced to them earlier in the story. He began to be sorrowful and troubled. Reflect on the God Christianity offers the world. It's not the distant God. The God, you know, the ancient gods that would be way up in the heavens and they never experienced the brokenness and the pain and the doubt of real life. And here's the God Christianity offers the world, the God who actually feels sorrow and is troubled. The great hymns talk about man of sorrows. The idea that Jesus Christ, God himself, enters the world and feels. You know that pain you feel? You know the doubt you feel? You know the tragedies you've experienced in your life? The death of people? The addictions? The mistakes you've made? The sins that so easily entangle you at any age? I don't care if you're a 14-year-old or you're 85. We all experience the mistakes and the failure and the troubles and the sorrow of life. And if you haven't yet, you will. And what Christianity offers you that is different than every other religion, if you're someone exploring and watching this weekend, we're glad you're here. If maybe you're not a Christian, maybe you're of another religion or an agnostic or an atheist, what you get in Jesus is the God who knows brokenness. He identifies with your sorrow and troubledness. And he not only identifies with it, this weekend is all about how he reverses it, how he solves it, how he deals with it, how he meets it and gives you a life on the other side of it. That's the beauty of this weekend. That's the beauty of Good Friday and why when I first started going to the church, I didn't understand what they called it good. How could a day where a man is beaten to death, an innocent man, a pure man, a righteous man, a good man, and we killed him, how could that be good? And then I began to understand what it meant and I realized, man, good might not be a word that's enough. Great. You know, Jim Collins, who's this business leader, wrote a book years ago, Good to Great. He said, good is the enemy of great. It's Great Friday. It's a day that accomplishes the thing we all needed it to accomplish. And how did it happen? Through victory in the sense that we think of it? Through hey, health and wealth and all the great things in your life? And I hope, no, through sorrow and troubledness. That's how victory actually ends up happening in life. Unfortunately. It's a cruciform pattern stitched into history, stitched into our very existence, that we will feel the pressure and the sorrow and the troubledness, but out the other side of it, there is victory because in those moments, Jesus draws close because those things were the very means by which he accomplished what he came to do. The defeat of Satan, sin, and death, the things that entangle and derail your very life. He began to be sorrowful and troubled. These aren't, you know, in an atheist view of the world, in an agnostic view of the world, all sorrow and trouble is a sideline. It's to be avoided. It's to run away from it. Even in some New Age and Eastern mysticism philosophy, it's an illusion. It's not real. All of these worldviews basically say it has no place in the story. Christianity says all the trouble and pain and sorrow of life actually has a purpose. It has a meaning. That's why you can get up in the morning and realize it's shaping you in the same way it shaped Jesus and his very accomplishment. Verse 38, then he said to them, my soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me. And going a little further, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, "My Father, do you relate to God as Father or just one to fear?" I know some of you had bad fathers, but the purest form of fatherhood is this one who protects and loves and provides, fights for. I know the image I heard one writer say is, you know, you have a king and no one dares wake the king in the middle of the night. But if his own child runs in the room at 2 o'clock in the morning and shakes his father awake and says, "I need a cup of water, I'm scared, Daddy," then the king's not going to be angry. This is the way we get to relate to God, is he's Father, we are son, we are daughter. And so Jesus has this beautiful relationship, "My Father," he says, not, "Hey, distant God that I don't know and I'm trying to earn my way," "My Father, if it be possible," he says, "let this cup," verse 39, "pass from me." What cup? All through the Old Testament, it was the cup of God's wrath on the world. God was going to pour out his wrath because of sin and brokenness and pain and destruction. He was going to pour out his cup of wrath. And here's Jesus now in the garden knowing what's ahead. And he says, is there a way where this cup, this wrath, see, there's some theologies out there that don't understand the cup enough. They don't want to give you a version of atonement where God actually meets his wrath out on Jesus because they're afraid that you're going to be like, "I don't like a God of wrath. I don't like a God who's angry." But the reality is that's a very kind of 21st century latte sipping, you know, "I'm happy" in North America kind of philosophy of God. We're all around the world. The concept that God also, yes, he is love. He is pure, he is holy, and because of those things, there is a side of him that meets out wrath. But of course, the beautiful part of this is he meets it out on Jesus. You see, in the ancient times, you would have to sacrifice things so the gods wouldn't be mad at you anymore. Sacrifice your grain, sacrifice your money, sacrifice your very children. But here, in the concept of Christianity, it explodes out into the world and says God gave his own child up so that his wrath could be put on him. So it wouldn't have to be put on you. There's no more pilgrimages to be done. There's no more sacrifices to be made. There's no more children to be sacrificed for some atonement. Here, the cup is about to be poured out on the Son, and the Son knows it. And so he says, this cup, is there any way, Father, it can pass from me? Is there any other way to do this? Isn't this beautiful? People who don't trust the Gospels, they say, well, you know, the early church kind of made this story up. This is why scholars, left and right, trust the Gospels, because they leave in stuff that if you were trying to create a religion, you should just delete it. If you want to whitewash Jesus, delete this one. Delete this verse from the Bible, because it's like, I thought Jesus was kind of like knew what he was doing, and I didn't think he was going to have doubts. I didn't think he was going to have fear and sorrow and trembling and be scared and actually ask God, "Hey, I know I've been doing this thing for 33 years, but now at the last moment, the night where I'm sitting in the garden." This is actually a picture behind me of the Garden of Gethsemane itself. So picture yourself there in that historic moment, and he's on his face praying, and his prayer is there any other way to get this done? You experience that every day. Is there any other way to get your will done? And we try to kind of take it in our own hands. We think that we know the better way for our joy to flourish. We think we know the better way to accomplish what we should be accomplishing on earth. We want to wrestle that away from God. But then he says, not as I will, but as you will. In the end, he has this moment, and then he goes, but I got to do what you want to do. That's the answer when you start wrestling things. See, God knows the way to your ultimate joy far better than you do. And when we begin to recognize that, we begin to go, This is about God's way, not my way. And he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, so could you not watch with me 1 hour? 1 hour you couldn't watch. And then he says, verse 41, watch and pray. I love that. That you may not enter into temptation. You want to know what the secret to defeating temptation in your life is? Watch and pray. Watch, wake up, focus, realize this is sin. This is derailing my life. I don't know where to go with this. This is you got to wake up to it. You got to realize it. Watch. Don't avoid it. Don't be dumb to it. Don't be ignorant to it. Recognize it's derailing your life. It's an alternative vision of flourishing that Satan's putting there and sin is putting there and the culture around you is putting there. That's the temptation. Do this sin. Keep doing this sin. It makes you feel good. It's how you're going to win. Watch. Pay attention. Open your eyes. Don't be blind to it. Don't be dumb to it. And then pray. Simple solution. Wake up and pray. When you start to feel tempted, pray. Father, let me actually want to do what you want me to do versus what I want to do. Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. That's the secret. Yeah, but I don't know what to do with this temptation. Watch and pray. Watch and pray. Watch and pray. He says, the Spirit, speaking to them about their sleeping, indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. All of us have a spirit. Whether you're a Christian or not, a spiritual life, a spiritual inclination. We want to accomplish great things. We know that we have a consciousness. We know we dream of the deeper transcendent things of life. That's the human experience. That's why beauty, that's why transcendence, that's why consciousness, that's why we look at the world and we're not happy with it the way it is. See, if we were just animals, we wouldn't know of anything else. We would just go, well, this is the way it is. Nature is red in tooth and claw and it's hard and it's tough, but we dream of another world. We dream of a different world. And if nothing, as one writer said, if nothing in this world satisfies that longing, it must mean we were made for another world. Another kind of world. This is why he's saying the Spirit, that's strong. I know you want to stay awake. I know you want to be in this fight with me. Isn't that our life? We want to be in this fight. We want to serve God. We want to please God. But the flesh is weak. Man, I'm tired physically. I get anxiety. I get fear. I want to do good things. I just keep falling to the things of the world because they're easier and they're right in front of me. And they're, Jesus, it's a rebuke, but it's also like a, guys, I get it. And maybe some of you just need to hear that. I get it. I'm here. I'm with you in it. I'm going to walk you through it. Again, for the second time, he went away and prayed. My Father, if this cannot pass, unless I drink it, your will be done. Ultimately, he's going, I want to do the will of God. If this is the only way to do it, then I'll drink it. The courage here, the recognition. And again, he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. There's such a great contrast between the disciples and Jesus. And that contrast needs to get to the core of our being. We are the disciples in this story, not Jesus. And when you're reading the Bible, recognize Jesus is accomplishing something we could never accomplish. We are the ones sleeping, and here's Jesus. Their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words again. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, sleep and take your rest later on. See, the hour is at hand. The hour of my sorrow, the hour of my suffering is at hand. And the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise and let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. This is like a scene in a movie. See, my betrayer is at hand. And then, who's the betrayer? While he was still speaking, Judas came. Judas, the betrayer. One of the 12. I mean, that's like a painful. This is a guy who's spent 3 years every day joking around with Jesus, having fun around the fire with Jesus, traveling, experiencing all the crazy things, people rising from the dead, feeding of 5,000, demons cast out of people, crazy stuff. He's experienced this. He's seen this, and he betrays him. It's scary. Think about your own life. Do you understand that human psychology is such that you're going to go with your gut over your reason almost every time? You're going to go with the sparkle versus the logical every time almost. I'm terrified of flying in airplanes. I do it a lot. I mean, not since COVID, but... And every time I do it, I'm scared. But all the data in the world tells me once I get into that plane, I'm in the safest place on the planet. But still, my gut tells me I should be scared. And we go with that every time because it's more powerful. And here is Judas. He is seen. Some of you are like, I believe in Jesus. If he, you know, if I could see people rise from the dead, would you? Or would your affections for the sparkle make you betray him? Even if you saw with your own eyes. See, that's the scary thing. We could look at all the evidence in the world and we could say we believe it, but do we glory in it to the point where we can discipline? You know, one writer has said that one of the great acts of discipleship in the modern world is self-disobedience. Think about that. That you ultimately have to be disobedient to yourself. Because one of the things yourself will do is derail you. You will, through insecurity, sabotage yourself with relationships, with God, with people, with work, friendships. Somehow you got to be able to transcend what you feel in a moment and covenant yourself to something that trumps how you feel, something you know. And here's Judas. He's seen the risings from the dead. He's seen the people healed. He's seen the miracles. And someone offers him money. And he falls to money. How many of you have fallen to the temptation of money and it's derailed your very soul to the point where you betray him? Substitute money for whatever your thing might be. It's all of our lives. Every day we fight this very temptation. So I know we're quick to throw Judas under the bus, and obviously no one calls their kids. You know, We all name the kids. There's a lot of people name their kids after in the Bible. Hey, Andrew and Matthew and John. No one names their kid Judas. Never met a Judas. But we'd be betraying the story if we didn't realize that every day we have a potential to be him. And with him a great crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Seize him." And he came up to Jesus at once and said, "Greetings, Rabbi." And he kissed him. Of course, this is where we get betrayed with a kiss. Calls him Rabbi through the whole thing. It's very interesting. Through the Gospel of Matthew, all the other disciples are calling him Lord. And Judas keeps calling him Rabbi, as if he never really kind of came to the point where he's like, I'm sold out to this thing. But of course, he betrays him with a kiss. Think of that tension. We might literally give lip service to Jesus and betray him in our heart. For silver and gold? I know people who derail their life for dumb earthly things like money or more square footage or shiny stuff. Sell their soul for it. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you came to do. I know you're betraying me with a kiss." Then they came up and laid hands on Jesus and seized him. And behold, one of those who were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. The other gospels tell us this is Peter.
he pulls a sword out, one of Jesus' own disciples, and cuts the ear of one of the servants of the high priest off. Then Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword." Don't you get it? I'm not here to do a national thing. I'm not here to make this, you know, earthly world great and put everything back together again from a nationalistic and political, and I'm not here to fight geopolitical wars as much as Christianity has been used like this all through history. Jesus goes, "I'm not a sword guy. So what I'm here to do, you could build great cultures and still everybody in those cultures would die and go to a Christless eternity. Is that what I really want? That's not my battle. That's not my fight." Ephesians tells us the ultimate battle is not against flesh and blood. It's a spiritual one. Jesus is like, "Are you so simplistic you want to fight geopolitical wars with swords? Create a what? A big culture that has great things in it for your 85 years? I got a deeper thing I'm trying to accomplish here. You're going to perish by the sword if you want to fight by it," he says. "Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels?" A very interesting phrase. A legion was in the Roman army. A legion was 6,000 very well-trained, like Navy SEAL soldiers. And the Roman Empire had a bunch of them. So he goes, "Don't you think I could send 12 times that right now of angels that can wipe out hundreds of thousands of people?" You go back in the Old Testament, you can see one angel shows up and wipe out 100,000 people. "I could call down 72,000 angels right now if I wanted. You think that sword's doing anything? Bro, this is happening. I'm not here to fight that. I'm here to do something far deeper." Sometimes in our life, we want God to do this thing and we're jacked up about it. It's like the guy who comes through the roof and he's paralyzed and his big ask is, "Can you help me walk again?" Why? So you can die in another 30 years? I want to solve a problem you don't even know you have. That's why Jesus goes, "Your sins are forgiven," to the guy. And he's like, I didn't even know to ask that. You got stuff wrong with you that you don't even know what to ask for. Jesus knows how to ask for it, and Jesus knows how to accomplish it in your place. That's why we put our lives in his hands versus ours. He says, "But how then should the scriptures be fulfilled that it must be so?" And at that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out as against a robber?" That's the Greek word also for revolutionary. Like not just a guy snatching purses in the marketplace, someone who's countering the whole structure of power and influence and definitions of sex and money and power and family that they all live in. And someone's kicking against that. That's the word. Revolutionary, someone who's trying to overthrow the way of the Roman Empire, and you come against me to arrest me like one of them with swords and clubs to capture me. "Day after day, I sat in the temple teaching and you did not seize me. But all this has taken place that the scriptures of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples left him and fled. I know, again, we always picture ourselves in Jesus' shoes, but I think that's more us. Every day the fight is to not leave him and flee. So then here's where the story lands. Later on in chapter 27 of Matthew, verse 26, Pilate released and scourged Jesus, released Barabbas, and then scourged Jesus and delivered him to be crucified. Really quickly just says that scourging was terrible. It was, you would take this leather strap with bones and metal at the end of it, and you would beat someone with it on their back and on their front to the point where intestines would be exposed. Some people just died from the scourging. They just died from that alone. And he just covered his whole body with this strap that would go in and grab the skin and rip it off. And the beating begins of Jesus after a false trial, an illegal trial at night. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters and they gathered the whole battalion before him. All these soldiers and they stripped him. So here he is. Sometimes we pass over this. Here, our Lord becomes, he's stripped naked . Have some of you experienced things like that in your life? Abuses that were so shame and guilt ridden, you can't get over them. In Christianity, we get God himself experiencing that kind of shame and guilt to the point where he's publicly naked. And a kind of abuse you wouldn't want on your worst enemy. And he's paying for that too. There's this doctrine within Christianity called expiation. And it's a beautiful doctrine. We rarely ever talk about it. But the New Testament goes on to explain it as Jesus suffers and dies, listen to me, not just for the sins that you do, but for the sins that are done against you. Some of you need to hear that today. The abuses, the shame, the guilt, the betrayal, whatever has experienced at whatever level in your life, Jesus Christ goes through it in order to reverse it and redeem you. I read something today about a pastor. He said the greatest thing after preaching so many sermons in his life, the greatest thing someone ever said to him was after this 45-minute sermon, a woman walked up to him and said, "I feel like God loves me more than I've ever felt it in my life." That's what I want you to feel as we reflect even on this brutal moment. This was all done, driven by love. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. That's why he does it. That's what motivates the suffering and the pain and the agony and the sorrow. And the being stripped naked and mocked because he loves you and he wants to redeem those experiences and take them away and bring you into a new reality. That's why he goes through them. That's the gift. Don't leave the gift sitting there unopened. It's sitting there wrapped. If you don't apply it to the shame and the guilt and the betrayal that you've experienced in your life, that you can walk in the newness of life. They put a scarlet robe on him, which was, of course, irony because it's royal, and twisting together a crown of thorns. His stuff becomes so, like we hear it so many times and we've seen so many pictures and movies. Don't let it fall on you flat. He's sitting with a crown of thorns. I touch a rose thorn and it bleeds out. Pressed into his skull. They're beating him. He's naked. He's probably half dead at this point. People died just from the scourging and the flogging. They put a reed in his right hand, and kneeling before him, they mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews." And they spit on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. When they mocked him, they stripped him of the robe, naked again, and put back on his own clothes. And led him away to crucify him. You know, the Gospels, they don't go into a bunch of detail about what the crucifixion experience was like. C.S. Lewis pointed out years ago that the only time history ever started painting pictures of Jesus on a crucifix and using it in art was when pretty well everyone who had ever seen a crucifix used was already dead. Because Constantine outlawed crucifixion in the Roman Empire in the 300s. See, it was so terrible that the gospel writers almost are just like, and they crucified him. Like, here's what happened. And of course, the mocking. Sometimes we feel like that's kind of the least of Jesus' problems in this story, but man, you ever been mocked? You ever had people make fun of you? Never had people just like shame, even publicly or online or something. You want to defend yourself, right? Like, what is this jerk doing sitting around? What's this guy accomplished critiquing me on? What's going on here? Does he know my heart? Does he know why? Shame and mockery is tough. You ever heard of a friend of yours talking behind your back, throwing you under the bus, slamming you for something? You're like, how is that possible? Pretty tough. It's not small. And yet this is what he goes through. They take him away to Golgotha, the place of the skull. It's because it looks like a skull, this particular place in Jerusalem. It looks like there's two like sunken eyeballs and like a nose, and it's the place where they crucified these revolutionaries. And he sits, two robbers are crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And then it says in verse 45, now from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice. We miss this as 21st century people, but remember, this is Passover. And scholars point out that this is the time of day where people would be bringing their sacrifices in light of the Passover lamb that was being sacrificed so that God's wrath would pass over. And it, of course, it's a commemoration of Egypt, right? Where they came out of Egypt and God had said, my wrath's going to come down, and whoever has blood on the doorposts or the lintel of their homes, my wrath will pass over. And so this was the moment in their calendar where that was happening. And so Matthew's giving us a hint. This is the ultimate bloodshed, so the wrath of God passes over. And he says, with a loud voice, he cries out, verse 46. Do we picture kind of meek, mild Jesus, but here this is his dying holler. Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani, he says, it's Aramaic. One of only a few times in the Gospels where they actually cite the Aramaic. And it's a quotation from the Psalms. My God, why have you forsaken me? And I think the Gospel writers are trying to go, realize he has called him Father, 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 the whole time, the whole Gospel. And now here he is on the cross and he switches it, in quoting the Psalms, to my God. And there's almost like some kind of thing going on. Isaiah says it pleased the Lord to crush him. In this moment, this sacrifice, there's this isolation and separation from the Father. My God, instead of my Father, why have you forsaken me? I feel abandoned here. There's a distance between us I've never experienced in my life. What is going on? And God's going, I can't be unified with sin and the complexity of what's going on in the Godhead in the Trinity right now is the brain can't comprehend it. But here there's a forsakenness that is helping accomplish and accomplishing the atonement that Jesus is accomplishing for us. But it's God-oriented. We tend to just preach and reflect on how it affects us, but here it's a direction vertically. And some of the bystanders hearing it said, this man is calling Elijah. And one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But the other said, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him. Jesus cried out again. That would have been like something to help with the pain. But the other said, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come and save him. And Jesus cried out again and with a loud voice. Like, picture him bellowing, yellowing. It's echoing. Like, he's screaming. And yielded up his spirit. It's one of the saddest verses in the whole Bible. Jesus died. That's what happened. And then, as we move into a time of communion, Matthew tells us, gives us a hint when we're looking for it on what it all means. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook and the rocks were split. The temple was built so that God could be accessed. And there was a curtain there that would keep the normal people out. And there's a whole system of the priests would enter a certain time of year and offer a sacrifice. And all of it was about atonement, reconciling to God, forgiveness of sin, And because the cross happens, it is no longer necessary. The temple is over. Religion, as we say often here at Village Church, is over. It can't save you because Jesus and his work is the only thing that saves us. That's why the temple becomes redundant. The temple the curtain gets torn, and now humankind is invited in to experience the presence of God because sin is forgiven in principle, but now there's a question of whether we take that accomplishment and apply it to ourselves or not, which is how the story then ends. When the centurion and those who were with him keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake after the crucifixion and the tearing of the temple and what took place, they were filled with awe and said, "Truly, this was the Son of God." That is the question we all must answer. Do you look at this story? Do you look at this weekend and go, "Great that it happened, moving on with my life"? Or do you go, "I look at it with awe and I actually shift from a skepticism to this man really was the Son of God and I'm going to give my life to it. I'm going to organize my whole heart and mind around this reality versus the reality of just living how I want to live." This is the definitive question. In one of the other gospels, they tell us that these two thieves on either side of Jesus, one of them said, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And the other one said, "I don't believe in this guy." And all of history is represented with those two responses to Jesus. Either you say, "Remember me when you come to your kingdom," or you go, "I don't want anything to do with this guy." Which one are you? Truly, this man was the Son of God. I'm in awe, or blip on the radar in history. I'm the center of the story. Those are your two options. And so on this Good Friday, whether you're by yourself or with your families, we commemorate this moment with communion. The dinner that Jesus just came from before he entered this first garden that we're talking about this weekend, it was the Passover meal, and he took it and he made it about him. He took a cup of wine and he said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, shed for you, not spilt." Spilt's like by accident. I shed it. I knew what I was doing. And when you take of this cup and drink it in remembrance of me, this is a commemoration of that blood shed so that you might have sin forgiven and be reconciled to God. And then the bread is my body, broken, torn apart. Isaiah says he was beaten beyond the semblance of a man. You couldn't even tell. Broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And so we take the bread and we eat it. And we drink the cup and we do both these things. If you're not a Christian, this isn't something that you would participate in. It's something that you do when you go, "I'm in awe. And this man truly was the Son of God." Then this becomes the center of your worship. If that's not you yet, that's fine. But maybe you're believing that for the first time ever. And in this moment, then, you can participate, maybe your first communion, where you eat the bread, you drink wine, grape juice, whatever it is, your context is symbolizing this great moment, the greatest moment, the apex moment of the history of the universe and your history too. Father, I pray now as we reflect, as we partake, that our hearts would be in awe of what you did for us. Personally, Jesus, thank you for this immense suffering and sorrow in order to pay for my sin, the sin of my past, the sins I continue in, the sins of my future, all paid for in this moment. When you declared, as in one of the other gospels you did, "It is finished. It is finished." And I pray that everyone watching this right now feels that accomplishment and worships in light of it. In your powerful name we pray, Jesus. Amen. We'll be right back.